Welcome to Catholic Homeschool Radio, where we begin conversations to help parents enrich their lives and make practical decisions for the future.
Today, Dr. Alice von Hildebrand talks on love, friendship, and charity. She takes as inspiration the words from Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, the Oratorio. Whoever has been lucky enough to become a friend to a friend, whoever has found a beloved wife, let him join our songs of praise. Yes, and anyone who can call one soul his own on this earth, any who cannot, let them slink away from this gathering in tears.
And it may it all be for God's glory. That's good enough. Coming to the end of my life and looking back upon my life, I realize more and more the tremendous gift that friendship is. Now, first of all, I would like to make a distinction between love and friendship. You know, the world is so rich and our vocabulary is limited. And I personally regret deeply that the word love is used in totally different contexts. You know, one thing is certain, if you speak of the love of God, you mean something which is unique, because there is only one God. But there's a love of husband for wife and wife for husband. There's a love of between the sexes, which is a sublime and beautiful world that you find in holy friendships. There is a love between brother and sister. But you also speak of the love of nature, of the love of music. And to my regret, we speak of the love of food, of the love. You know, somehow it is most regrettable, because then you mean something so different, and it is misleading. We should never say, I love candies. You know, we should reserve this word. Now, speaking about human love, there are two things which I believe should be strongly distinguished. A love between husband and wife, wife and husband, and also something that I have referred to in one of my books, holy friendships, which do not necessarily imply marriage, but implies that it is one man and man-woman after created man. God said, it is not good for man to be alone. I mean, in other words, it makes it clear that to be a person implies communion, and communion implies love. Now, therefore, this is already a hint at the Blessed Holy Trinity, that God is one God in three different persons, and their union is a union of love. Therefore, love, communion, gives us a key to an understanding of persons. When you turn to friendship, a totally new difference happens. Number one, a friendship is possible between two people of the same sex. It is possible between two men, it is possible between two women, and it is also possible between a man and a woman, even though they are not married. But what we need to see in a moment, it then is a very, very different type of relationship. In the case of love, in the strict sense of the term, it's possible between one man and one woman. This type of love is possible between two women and two men. And what is characteristic of it is what my husband has called, and I believe he says, it is a unique I-thou relationship. Only two people. And he says I-thou because they look at each other's eyes. And looking at another person's past, you have a sort of unique insight into the beauty of this particular soul. You know, I would say simply that these great loves are characterized by the fact that God gives us a key to what he meant when he created that particular person. Now, each one of us is a thought of God which is realized then in the flesh. Each thought of God was beautiful, but obviously, because of original sin, many of us betray it. And this very moment, things become very different. Now, between Adam and Eve, there was one unique relationship which is symbolic of marriage, one man and one woman. Why only one man and one woman? Because they are complementary. A woman can give to a husband something that she alone can give, that no other male can give her, and vice versa. And therefore, a question which is stupid, and for this reason very popular in the world in which we live, is what is superior, man and woman? An idiotic question cannot be answered because it is idiotic. They are meant to be different, and they are meant to be different means to say that you cannot compare them. You know, I mean, very much as if you say, what is better, concave or convex? Well, because there is no convex without concave and convex without convex. So I simply say they are meant to be different and complementary. Now, this not and now comes, finally, the thing that I've promised to talk about, friendship. Friendship differs essentially from this adult relationship, which in many cases leads to marriage or can lead to a holy friendship, which is unique and irreplaceable. Is that number one, it can be between two women. I look back on my life, and one of the words that comes to my lips is thank you. Because I don't recall, even when I was in grammar school, that I ever was without someone that I call friend. I recall a very, very beautiful friendship I had in grammar school with someone called Nicole. And we'll meet after school and we have deep talks. I recall that we're reading Pascal together when I was 11 years old. It's an exchange. It is a joy of being together. It is a beautiful insight in who this person is going to be. There is warmth. There is an interchange of ideas. It is something very, very beautiful. And throughout my life, except that with age, not only the friendships became richer and more beautiful, but I can say I have many of them. And what is amazing about friendship, keep this in mind, is that you can have many of them. You cannot say, I love 3 men or 10 men so passionately, each one of them could be my husband. Then you don't love any one of them. But in the case of friendship, I see my relationship with the very many friends that I have, and new ones keep coming into my life. It's like a nursery of magnificent flowers. And no flower is a rival to another flower. You know, the fact that there are roses does not eliminate the beauty of lilies. And lilies do not eliminate the beauty of tulips and so forth and so on. And some of them are tiny little flowers. You take daisies. They're very tiny, they're very small. But nevertheless, we have to thank God that they're daisies. So don't eliminate daisies in your life because they're not lilies. They give you something else. So what is friendship? In the case of love between man and woman, it seems to me, if I were to talk from my own experiences, that in some way, God in his infinite goodness gives you an insight into the beauty that he intended when he created that particular person. It is very much as if it gives you a golden key, make you understand who this person is as meant at the moment of God's creation. And this is something which is unique. It's not given to you. I mean, usually it's given to you in one person. Hopefully, in some cases, it is your husband. It is your wife. It can be your child. But I mean, happy, let us say, quote, the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven that you read. Unhappy is a man who leaves this earth when he has never had a real marriage of souls. In the case of friendship, there are many, many flowers in God's garden. And number one, each one of them is welcome. Each one of them is a source of joy. Each one of them gives you rings, but there is no jealousy between them. It is inconceivable that a rose be jealous of a lily. And so all of them should be welcome. Now, let me try to be more specific. Let us leave, say, the love between man and woman, the great, great classical loves. You see, in any type of love, it seems to me, and now I'm quoting my husband, that there are two characteristics. Number one, that you see the beauty of another person's soul in different degrees, that it touches your soul. And the response is, I'm glad that you exist, and I would like to do you good. Let me use the Latin words, intentio benevolentiae, a kind, loving attitude. I wish to do you good. I'm looking for chances and opportunity to do good to you. But then there's also another thing in this, in very various degrees. The highest degrees is between man and woman in marriage or in spiritual love. The desire to be with, the desire to be united. You suppose I say to you, I like you very much, but I couldn't care less if I never saw you again. You know, this is inconceivable. Inevitably, when I start loving someone, I say, may we meet again. And of course, the closer the person is, the more you wish this intenso union, to be together, increases. And you can determine the depth of your friendship according to the intensity of your desire to see. And this is why I know people who take a long trip for the joy of seeing a friend they haven't seen, or the sacrifices that you're willing to make sure that you can see this person. Now, therefore, intenso benevolentiae, the desire to do another person good. And then, of course, the moment you discover what Christian love, you realize that, in fact, it should extend to all men. And this is what is called love of neighbor. Now, it is obvious that when you say love of neighbor, you're referring to all the people who come across. In some cases, these people might not be attractive. These people might behave very badly. These people might have offended you. But what is so glorious about Christian love is that, quite independently of how they behave towards you, you following the teaching of Christ, love them and approach them with a kind and a happy, you can do something for them, even though they behave. This is, of course, love of neighbor in the broader sense of the term. But then the closer you come to another person, the larger the field in which you try to express your love and to indicate whatever is good for them is a source of joy. Whatever benefits them is a, and in some way you can say, the great source of love for a Christian, as we should be, is when you realize that someone comes closer to God. Let me turn to one of the saints who has had the greatest influence in my intellectual development, St. Augustine. Now, St. Augustine led a bad life, unfortunately, then wake up and baptized is served towards holiness. But if you read this magnificent book called The Confessions, you're going to see that friendship played a tremendous role in his life. And he particularly mentions two men, Alypius and Nebridius. And he indicates that everyone they met, through their friendship and through their love of God was increased. So therefore, what is the most beautiful characteristic of either love in the strict sense or friendship? It brings us closer to Christ. This is the most perfect. But obviously, there's a tremendous gradation. Suppose that you share a love for sublime music. Well, this is also something which points to a better world. You share world of values. You share love for goodness. You share love for whatever is beautiful. But obviously, if you share love for tennis or for sport, well, it is something which is pretty harmless and it can be found to be together. But it's not going to make you grow wings. So therefore, the wish that all of us should have in friendship is to meet one or many souls that when we meet together, our hearts get warmer and we love God more the very moment that we left. We had an hour discussion with your friend Leif. Are you sure that actually you've come a little bit closer to you? And therefore, it seems to me that one of the things that must be constantly stressed when you speak about friendship, the desire that through my love for my friend, he becomes a better person and I become a better person. This is the key of it. And therefore, this intention, the kind intention and loving intention, creates between us a bond which is going to resound to eternity. One thing is certain, I'm convinced that when God calls me and brings me on the other side, it's not going to separate me from my friends, even though it's only in heaven that friendship will blossom completely and totally. And therefore, if you were to say to me, one is the greatest gifts that are left on this earth, in spite of original sin, I'll say friendship. May we all pray that God teaches us how to become friends and to appreciate friendship and to end our life with the word, thank you.